Well, hello, Harvest. It's good to be with you today as we share just a moment of encouragement from God's Word. Over the next 8 or so minutes, I would love to just encourage you in your journey with the Lord and maybe taking your next steps in a question that I asked at the end of the sermon last weekend. I said, God has entrusted so much into our hearts and into our lives. The question is, what am I doing with what God has entrusted to me? How should I use what he's given me, the time that he's given me, the treasures that he's given me, the talents that he has given me? What can I do to be able to take that further? It brings to mind a word that sometimes we struggle with, and maybe you even heard it as a child. Son, you have so much potential. You have so much potential. What does that really mean to have potential? Obviously, it's something that's not realized, but it's something that we're striving for. And I believe that Jesus, as he invested in the disciples, as we've been looking in the book of Mark, he was investing in people who had potential. And they had potential to do one thing that he had tunnel vision focus on, is to love others. What did it mean to love others and bring them into a knowledge of what he had come to do on the cross? Well, there's a scripture in Luke chapter 19, verse 10. It says, "For the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost." The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Well, a little background. There's a text that came right before that verse. The 9 verses of chapter 19 talk about a man named Zacchaeus. He was a tax collector. He was very wealthy. He was not loved in the community. He was very short. He was in a tree, and Jesus invited him to come down and meet him. And Jesus says these words, "I must go to your house today, Zacchaeus." And I don't know about you. You may not be able to comprehend how radical it was of what Jesus said. But Jesus asked a person who was far from God, "I need to come to your house to spend time with you." It made me wonder, who in your life is far from God that you enjoy spending time with? That you would not hesitate to go and spend time with them to be able to connect with them? People who are different than us. See, I think that we should begin to say yes to people who've said no to God. People who've said no to what we believe. People who've said no to the church. People who've said no to Jesus. And even people who just don't know. I think that we should grow in our compassion and in our heart of saying yes to those people. See, this will require many of us to push back against insider thinking about church, that it's just me, us four, and no more. We don't want anybody else in our huddle because we're excited about being in church. But see, I think Jesus was more excited about what happens outside the walls of the church. I think Jesus was very serious about talking to outsiders and spending time with them and getting a connection with them. See, I don't see a lot of outsiders coming to Jesus, or even frankly to myself, saying, "Hey, if you guys do this, I will come to spend time with you. If you do this, I might start attending church." Instead, I get conversations, sometimes anonymous, with people who say, "Well, if you don't do this or that, you don't play this type of music, you don't do this type of program, we may leave the church." I don't think that is the heart of Jesus. And I think if we're not careful, what we'll begin doing is we'll begin crafting churches and communities that look like us, but don't look like the heart of Jesus. So what should we do? How should we respond? I think that there are a couple ways that we can begin to say yes. The first is begin to say yes by listening more. Cheryl Bocklander, she is the former CEO of Popeye's Chicken, and she led an amazing turnaround. Some of you guys enjoy their sandwiches and have stood in line. When she was asked what the most important action that she took to implement the kind of change that was happening, she said, "I went on a listening tour." That was it. She went and she listened to people. And I think that's a big idea. We live in a world where everyone is shouting at each other, but no one is really listening. The question is, how can you listen better to use the gifts that God has entrusted in your care? But the second thing is an example of what it means to listen. A few years ago, they had a study that was done by Barna, and they wanted to talk with a group called Knowns, N-O-N-E-S. And they wanted to ask why they have no religion, no sense of faith, why they don't want to go to church. This is 18 to 34-year-olds. They live in the United States. They have no religion. And they asked the question, how interested would you be hanging out with a pastor or a staff member? I know many of you are probably sitting there going, man, that has to be at least 80%. Who wouldn't want to hang out with somebody like Pastor Ed? Well, you would be wrong. 84% of unchurched 18 to 34-year-olds said they're not interested in hanging out with a church pastor or a staff member. Well, if they're not interested in hanging out with me or us, how are we going to share the good news of Jesus Christ? There was a glimmer of hope, though, on the listening tour that happened. Because then they asked this question, what, if anything, would you like or that you would like about church? And the number one answer was community. See, I think something would happen if we created community that people not only liked being a part of and coming to. It does not mean watering down our beliefs. I think people would be more likely to come to church if they honestly could find a church that they could relate to. People who were honest about their sins and their shortcomings. People who were honest about the realities of the things that they face in their lives. People who are honest that they don't have all the answers, but they're seeking someone who does. So how can we help? I think we can say yes by having more of a common language. Jesus said that he was the Son of Man, and he came to seek and save people who were lost. That's why you hear us say that we're for Chicago, we're for Crystal Lake, we are for Deerfield Road, we're for Aurora, we're for the Rolling Meadows, we're for the Cathedral Campus. We're for the Elgin campus. Why are we for these communities? We're for these communities because we believe that God is for them. And we believe that in these communities, God has potential. There are people who are not yet in the walls of our church who God wants to use to help us reach the world. So today, as we close, I really believe that something very powerful happens when people of God begin to say yes to people who've often said no. Over the next 2 days, we're going to have a chance to be able to listen and learn together. Tomorrow night, I want to invite you back. We're going to be talking with Sheila Wise Rowe, the author of Healing Racial Trauma. And we're going to be listening and learning together as we take our steps further in growing together and learning about the realities of race and the nexus with the gospel and how we can be the church that is the beloved community that God is calling for. It's going to be at 7:30 tomorrow night, Thursday. Tell your friends. We look forward to joining you. Pastor Greg and I are going to be having the conversation along with Sheila Wise Rowe. So have a great day. May God bless you, and may you, like Jesus, seek those who are far from Jesus. May you spend time with them, and may you come to know the joy of what it means to listen, pursue, and love those who have potential. God bless you.